So maybe, you know, super strength, super speed, maybe, you know, through neural link, the puppy is come to say hello again. Hey puppy, what are you trying to do? You want some food? Welcome back, my friends. So today we're gonna check out a new show, the new Cyberpunk Edgerunner show that is on Netflix. You might know, if you played the game, that the physics were kind of broken. So hopefully this TV show's physics are a little bit better. There's lots of memes about that. But anyway, before we get into the video, make sure you go check out the thing that I'm creating called CalVPN, a new kind of VPN. It's called a post-quantum VPN. It can protect you guys from quantum computers. So it kind of fits with futuristic cyber tech, right? You can actually use it for free right now. So we're trying to do some testing. We've released this alpha. It's only on Windows, but you can use the VPN for free. There's one server as well, but there's a whole bunch of servers coming. The beta, as well as the whole suite of apps are coming in about a month. So come get involved, come follow the journey, and go download it for free in the description at calvpn.com. All right, that was awesome. But I want to talk about that because we could relate that to some real physics. So if you were really to travel near the speed of light, strange things start to happen. And it almost looked like that's what they were trying to show, but there is some key differences. So you know how it went blue first and then, you know, it went multicolored. So I'm not sure if they're trying to, you know, support Pride Month or something, but let's talk about how it went blue. And then at one stage it went red. So this, they missed a golden opportunity to, I mean, I think it looks cooler this way, but they could have actually made it, you know, align with actual physics because he's brought over the, he wants to play tug of war. You win. No, I need that. As Einstein showed, funny things happen near the speed of light. They have to happen. You know, pretty much our conventional ideas of space and time, you know, they change near these speeds. So like, for instance, your nose, right? It's just a little closer to me than your ears. So light reflected off your nose reaches me just a little bit quicker than your ears, right? But now let's imagine that I have this magic camera, right? And I could see your nose and your ears at exactly the same time, precisely. With that camera, you'd take some pretty interesting pictures. So as you approach the speed of light, like at half the speed of light, right, you're actually almost catching up with your own light waves. This compresses the light waves in front of you, right? And the image of him becomes blue. The shorter wavelength is actually what makes blue light waves blue. And also, you know, like the object would become skinny in the direction of motion. And that's not just some optical illusion. That really happens when you travel near the speed of light. And as he actually moved away from you, he would leave his own light wave stretched out behind him, right? And long light waves are red. And we say that, you know, his sort of receding image is red shifted. So now let's imagine this guy's point of view. What would he see? What would his vision look like? It's actually even stranger. Everything he can see, right, is squeezed into like this moving window just ahead of him. Blue shifted at the center, red shifted at the edges, right? And you'd see this round object. And to passers by, he would seem blue shifted as they approach him and blue shifted as they go past, right? But to him, you know, the world is nearly coming and going at the speed of light. So again, to people around, he would appear blue shifted when approaching and red shifted when receding. But to him, the entire world, you know, is just coming and going at nearly the speed of light. And, you know, things you passed, you know, things you already got going past, they would still appear at the edges of the forward point of view, but distorted and redshifted. So, you know, when he slows down, everything again will start to look normal. It's only very close to the speed of light does the world get squeezed into like a kind of tunnel, literally. You would really see these distortions if you could travel near the speed of light. And someday, perhaps, interstellar navigators, you know, they might take their bearings on stars behind them
whose images are all crowded together in the forward view screen. So if they wanted to make this obey real physics, all they had to do was, you know, blue shift him when he's coming towards people and make him skinnier, as well as, you know, things around age. So he's traveling into the future. And then when he's moving away, he goes red and his sort of image gets stretched. And that's what these other people would see. And for him, they could show his perspective, you know, that tunnel vision I was talking about. So I think that would have been cool, but it still looks awesome. I just use this as an excuse to teach you guys some physics.
これだけの子。お、あれよ。これで今日9回。いや、10回目だ。やべえな。やっぱこいつ行かれてるぜ。チャンスをくれ。チャンスだ。何のチャンスだ。何か仕事をやらせてくれ。うまくやってみせる。
I think another thing we need to chat about, you know, to make something like this possible is, like, you're going to need to also implement something that changes the way our brain perceives time, right? Because imagine you're able to move at these extreme speeds. Your brain's not going to change. Your brain's not going to be able to process doing things that quickly. So obviously there needs to be some upgrades there. This actually reminds me of a study I read recently, how scientists have broken the direction of time down to the cellular level in like this mind-bending study, right? So it was looking at interactions between like microscopic neurons in salamanders, right? To understand how like the arrow of time is biologically generated, essentially. And they did this by making them watch two movies, right? One with like an obvious arrow of time and one without, like all over the place. And they found that the interactions between simple pairs of neurons primarily determine the arrow of time, no matter which movie the salamanders watched. And in fact, they actually found a stronger arrow of time for the neurons when the salamanders watched a video without an arrow of time in its content. And that elicited a greater arrow of time in the neurons. And they naively thought that if a stimulus had a stronger arrow of time, that would show up on their retina, right? But it was actually the opposite. So that's why it was surprising to them. But anyway, I bring up this study because, as I was saying, like, if you're going to be able to move at these quick speeds, you'll have to change something in the brain. So maybe that is possible as well. You know, with studies like the one I just told you, you know, we might be able to figure out a way just to accommodate us moving at quicker speeds. It all sounds like absolute sci-fi, and look, it's extremely speculative, but who knows what's possible. So yeah, maybe one day everyone's going to be Bruce Lee, because this could really actually happen. And it would be terrible at schools, because again, something like this could happen where, you know, wealthy parents are able to, you know, download to give their kids that, you know, Bruce Lee software, and then bullying becomes something like this. It would make it worse, right? Because nowadays, at least, if you're getting bullied, you can go lift some weights or something and or learn how to fight. What can you do here? You know, your bullier is Bruce Lee.
素晴らしいですね。デイビッド・マルティネス君、規定の制服なしとかふざけるなよ。俺が恥ずかしくて学校に来れないぜ。もうアップデートに対応してないだろ。対応させた。どういう意味だ。そういう意味さ。お金の問題だけではないですがね。
So I just wanted to pause here and say that this guy's story kind of mirrors mine a lot. Like, you know, I come from a single mom. I grew up in poverty, went to a really bad school, and then I managed to get this scholarship to like the best school in my country. And people literally used to call me a rat. Like, I come from this suburb, and people who come from this suburb, they'd get called packy rats. I'm not even kidding. It was most often as a joke, right? Some of my friends, as a joke, would call me a packy rat. So, yeah, and I also do this as well, fidgety. I'm extremely fidgety. That obviously has nothing to do with this stuff, at least I think. But anyway, I just wanted to tell you guys that. And, you know, if you're young out there, definitely apply for some scholarships, because they actually give them out a lot more often than people realize. So yeah, definitely try your luck out there and apply for some scholarships. I was extremely lucky, and it was just luck, so give it a shot.
Yeah, it's an expensive course. Now it's a medical exam.
そうなんですか。
これ医療費と入院費の請求案内、あとお母さんの持ち物ね、支払いは3日以内にお願いします。
え、
俺もナイトシティでは保険には入りたいよ。お大事に。
バスケの
Just quickly, I think the society, you know, this show is painting really could be one we're heading for with, you know, potentially Neuralink, potentially withAI taking over most jobs. We really could be heading for something like this. You know, maybe a universal basic income being implemented in America could prevent this sort of future. But I think it's interesting to talk about, you know, because this is, I think it's a pretty good vision for the future.
いいもの見せてあげる。
おお、すげえ解像度。太陽熱い。
パーソナルリンク経由の設定だと熱すぎてやばいから、人が感じて大丈夫なくらいにはセーブしてるわ。
え、
何その格好。
So yeah, maybe this actually could eventuate as well. If Neuralink becomes a thing, maybe true virtual reality actually becomes popular, because currently it sucks. Everyone knows this. And have you seen the new devices that you know, virtual reality is trying to use for like talking? They look like torture devices. Imagine this, where it's like, you know, it's like a dream, but better than a dream. And I feel like at this point, if this happens, it could be dangerous, because people won't actually want to live in reality. They'll probably want to live in these simulated experiences. And then maybe we'll have like things that are the next evolution of movies. We'll have like cyber movies, you know, where it's like planned out and you experience the movie in first person or, you know, third person, you know, and games become obviously virtual reality. And it's just amazing to think about. This stuff could really happen if something like Neuralink is possible. And I just think that would be a fun world to live in. And, you know, this is kind of provides a solution to the Fermi paradox as well, where are the aliens? Well, maybe they're all, you know, living in their virtual reality Neuralink headsets, just having a great time. It'll be like that movie Ready Player One. And you know, I even think, you know, people prefer to live in these hyper real or like fantasy worlds, as some people speculate that maybe our universe is like this simulation and the substrate, what's outside it, could be a whole lot more boring. You know, like look at the movies we make, they're always jazzed up. You know, people jump 10 foot in the air and just, you know, triple somersault kicks, spins through doors and stuff like that. You see what I'm saying, right? Like everything is more extravagant in movies and games. And so maybe, you know, we'll prefer to live in these worlds where everything's more extreme and, you know, you get to be the absolute main character and everything. That could be coming. And we all and there's so many people around the world currently who think they're living, you know, in what will be the best time to be alive as a human in terms of, you know, the history. But things like this, if we don't kill ourselves, will probably become a reality. And you can bet people living in the future will probably look at our time and be like, oh, those poor people, they had to do all these things. They didn't have all these things. Just like we look at people who lived in the 1800s, like, my God, that must have been awful. The music in the scene is so good.
だが代金を払った途端、そいつと連絡が取れなくなった。
So Neuralink, maybe you can increase some things, but yeah, I wouldn't hope to be able to run as fast as speed light or anything, and I don't think that's what they're suggesting, but also you should actually consider, like, maybe this sort of thing is possible, because I'm sure you've seen what Elon's trying to do with Neuralink, right? And if all that stuff comes to fruition, maybe there's actually things you can do as well to manipulate like the central nervous system and all kinds of things, because strength doesn't just come from muscles, right? The central nervous system plays a vital role in your strength. And the most bizarre aspect of traveling near the speed of light is that time slows down. All clocks, mechanical and biological, tick literally more slowly near the speed of light. But stationary clocks, you know, they tick at their usual rate. And so if we travel close to light speed, we actually age more slowly than those we leave behind. And so for this guy traveling, you know, near light speed, yes, he would be traveling into the future. So for instance, if this guy was carrying a watch, right, his watch, as well as his internal sense of time, would show he's only been gone for, you know, a few seconds as he travels, or even a few minutes. But from their point of view, he would have been away for like decades, and you know, his friends would have grown up and moved on and died. This was, you know, just a thought experiment, right? But atomic particles traveling near the speed of light really do decay more slowly than stationary particles. So as strange and as counterintuitive as it seems, time dilation is a law of nature. Traveling close to the speed of light is a kind of elixir of life. Because time slows down close to the speed of light, special relativity provides us with a means of going to the stars. So the cyberpunks in the show kind of represent like the allure of the more deviant methods of, you know, like climbing out of poverty. You know, methods that aren't exactly moral, right? At least by societal standards. But who hasn't been enticed by, you know, these sorts of methods? I don't recommend going full cyberpunk. You know, I do think climbing out of, you know, dark places in life does require dancing on the edge. So yes, I'm encouraging you to break some friggin' rules, because, you know, after all, like all these rules, they just arbitrarily define things we, you know, hairless monkeys have conjured up. The only laws you really can't break are the laws of physics, right? But I'd also encourage you to try and break those too, because if you do, then you'll win a Nobel Prize and, you know, the associated money, and voila, you've made it out. That'll do for today's video, guys. I hope you enjoyed. Make sure you go download the free VPN, CalVPN, that I've made, and tell me what you want me to watch next, and I'll see you in the next one.